Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Ontario Aquaculture Research Centre. I'm your host, Kaylee Moore, one of the agricultural assistants here at OARC. If you're looking to learn more about aquaculture, you're in the right place. On today's episode, we have John Relyea Voss joining us to talk about his current role at Cermaq Canada.
Hey guys, and welcome back to our channel. Today, I'm super excited to introduce John Relyea Voss. Today, we will be discussing John's role at Cermaq Canada. Cermaq is a global company with farming operations in Norway, Chile, and Canada. Can you tell us, John, where your site is located and what your role is there?
Yeah, sure. And thanks for having me on today, Kaylee. So Cermaq has sea sites in three main areas of Vancouver Island. We have 14 sites on the west coast of the island, which is around the Tofino area. We have three sites in the Campbell River area, which is the mid-east coast of the island. And then we have six sites that are located at the north end of the island in the Broughton Archipelago. So for this interview today, I'm at our Wellis Bay farm, which is one of our north sites in the Broughtons. And I'm actually in the farm right now. So this barge is a three-story barge, and this is kind of our living quarters. I wish the weather was a little bit nicer so you could see the farm out behind me a little bit, but it's kind of rainy, which is pretty regular for this time of year. So yeah, you can kind of see what the location is like. But yeah, my role with Cermaq is assistant manager. So I'm responsible for overseeing the day-to-day operations of our farm. And this includes everything from feeding our fish, to caring for our fish, to monitoring our site environmental conditions, and managing a lot of our on-site projects. So as you can see, this barge is pretty nice. It's been here for a few months now, and it's one of the newest barges at Cermaq. And yeah, it's pretty exciting to work here. There's lots of cool projects that we have underway, and yeah. I wish I could, you know, say there's some pretty awesome views right now, but it's pretty rainy, so.
Yeah, maybe you can send over some photos of your site and I can input it into the video. So what you're talking about, I can show people as they watch this video and see. But yeah, we were just kind of talking about your site. So here at our center, we use an on-land tanks to grow our fish. You're currently living on a barge, so you guys use the natural environment. Can you outline kind of what that looks like for you?
Of course, using the natural environment to grow fish is, you know, of course, much different than your center, which would be, you know, a land-based setup. And, you know, growing fish, from my understanding, in tanks provides you with a little bit more control over your environmental conditions, and where growing your fish in the natural environment, like out here, means that you have to use a lot more tools and strategies to ensure that your fish are healthy and growing well, depending on what's happening in the environment. So working out in the Broughtons, that means that we have a lot of very strong tides, we have a lot of water movement, we have heavy winds and lots of rain very regularly. So during the summer months, we do have some beautiful days as well. However, the summer conditions also bring greater fluctuations in our water oxygen levels, as well as more regular occurrences of harmful plankton species that require some special attention and mitigation equipment. So examples of that would be using diffusers or tarps or bubble curtains to make sure that our fish are remaining pretty healthy.
We were just talking about, you know, high tide and like the different environmental risks. So can you kind of highlight the risk occupational factor difference between a net pen and a land-based station?
Yeah, so the main things that would come to mind for me, I guess, would be exposure to the elements and working in a very wide variety of weather conditions. So working on a remote site such as Wellis, it means you have to be pretty comfortable working in remote areas and being able to handle the challenges that come along with that. So, you know, whether it's our crew runs or just working out on the system when we have very heavy rain or, you know, really strong winds. For example, last shift we had some winds up in the North Island of upwards of 110 kilometers an hour. So you definitely got to be safe when you're working out there. But also, all of our new technicians remember a lot of really important environmental aspects and objectives. And some of those that I think would probably relate more specifically to NetPen operations over land-based stuff would be things such as trying to minimize wildlife interactions with, you know, with animals around the farm, or minimizing the risk of fish escapes or pathogen transfer from farm to wild salmon species, or minimizing other risks such as fuel spills or, you know, releasing marine debris into the environment as well.
Yeah, and that's, I think that's a good point. Like, I think they're, especially land-based here, like our facility, it's pretty hard to have an escapee and things like that here, just because, I mean, if we have an escapee, they are going to be landing on the floors and not into a body of water. But I mean, same thing, like we don't have to even think about, you know, water movement around us and wind and things like that. I mean, they set off our alarms here. Like if we have power flickers and stuff like that, we have a generator that will turn on, but we still have to come out and check. And I mean, we get some snow here. We don't get tons of rain at this time. We get lots of snow right now. So basically being here and being able to get the station blown out of snow so that we are able to access it at all times just in case of an emergency. So I think there's, I mean, we see risk factors in any workplace, but they all look very different just because of your surrounding area. And aquaculture is, you know, it all depends on what your water source is. So for you guys, it's using the natural environment. For us, we use well water. So our risks are different and they look different, but I'm sure you guys do a great job. That's I've never got to be actually out and check out a net pen. I definitely on my bucket list if I ever make it out west or the east coast to check out a farm, but I've seen some photos and things like that, and it looks like it's quite the experience to do that every day, show up and work on the water like that. So farms.
Cermaq does lots of tours. So if you're ever out on the West Coast, then I'm sure, there'll be an opportunity for you to come out and visit one of our sites.
Yeah, well, I'll definitely jump on that opportunity when it arises, hopefully once COVID passes. So farmed salmon is the main species of Atlantic Canada aquaculture industry. It represents approximately 80% of Atlantic Canada's total aquaculture value. Picking sites must be an important part of the equation. I mean, you guys from Atlantic, you farm Atlantic salmon, sorry, in cold, crisp waters. What criteria is used when selecting those sites?
Yeah, so choosing our sites is a very complicated process, and that's because there are so many variables to consider, and there are a lot of people that are involved in the decision-making process. As a site manager, that's definitely not something that I'm doing on a day-to-day basis. That's usually handled from a lot of hardworking people in our head office in Campbell River. So I'll do my best to answer the question appropriately. So first off, farms have to be away from high traffic areas, so that would include things such as harbors, marine shipping routes, and things like that. There's also biophysical factors to consider, such as our water quality around the farm, the tides, weather in the area, and whether or not we're near marine sensitive habitats or nurseries. So that would include things such as federal marine parks or clam beds or fish-bearing streams or kelp beds, things like that. And we also want to be looking at the benthic profile of our farms. So that would be the depth of water and the bottom current. And all this data is very important for the ongoing management of our farm. And most importantly, we want to be engaging with our local First Nations and understand any potential conflicts with cultural or resource areas. And we want to be selecting, or when we're selecting sites, we want to review our farm siting as a government to government.
No, perfect. Thank you. You know, not only just picking sites for your Cermaq, but even for starting up any aquaculture facility, there's a lot of different factors that play a huge role in starting up a farm or selecting a site. So thanks for sharing that little tidbit of info on what it looks like for you guys when selecting sites. I know, you know, like we mentioned before, aquaculture is really focused and relies on a lot of where your water is coming from. So I know picking those sites is, it's a lot of different factors and a lot of work coming together to make that decision. But is there any community services a part of that criteria? I know you kind of talked about it a little bit, but is there anything else that you can contribute?
Yeah, so as a company, Cermaq, of course, believes in adding value in where we live and work. And we do a lot of work with our communities to identify shared value. So we hold these as a really big priority when we're looking for ways to enhance the good that's already happening in our communities. And some of the things that Cermaq does includes sponsoring youth programs and events. We host a lot of farm tours for educational purposes. We do a lot of habitat and beach restoration projects that support wild fish populations. And every year we help more than, I think 2019, we did over 155 community events to support events, teams, and initiatives throughout Vancouver Island. So there's definitely a lot of things that we're doing as part of our community services with Cermaq. It's great to be a part of it.
No, that's awesome. We were talking about it today at lunch that, you know, it's really important to kind of you get interactive with the community and, you know, making people aware of, you know, what you guys are doing and what's going on, and being really like open book with it and, you know, sharing that with people. I mean, doing over 100, you know, community events, that's awesome for the community to see what's going on their coastlines. And that's kind of what started up this, you know, interview project that I'm doing, is to kind of, you know, open that book for people to kind of look in and say, oh, like what's going on in Ontario, or what's happening over, you know, with Cermaq, or, you know, any of these, all these different people I've got to interview, is just to open the book a bit more and be able to give to the community and say, like, this is what's happening in the aquaculture world. So I think it's fantastic that you guys are able to host so many events within your community. But I kind of wanted to talk about, before we wrap this up, kind of what the overview of how you ended up where you are today.
Sure. I'd love to. So like many salmon farmers at Cermaq, I'm actually an Ontario import. So I'm originally from Kingston, Ontario. And I moved out to the West Coast when I pretty much just sold all my belongings and packed what I had left into a Ford Focus and drove from Ontario out to Campbell River. I think that was the end of 2017. So I've been out here for a few years now. And my educational background is actually in business administration. However, I've had always a passion for the outdoors, and working with Cermaq has allowed me to, you know, to use the skills that I gained in my undergrad while also being able to follow my passions and, you know, work with or out in, you know, some of Canada's most pristine and wild areas. So it's been pretty awesome.
No, that's awesome. It's good to see the kind of two perspectives of, you know, we have a staff member that, you know, focused in, right in aquaculture. I personally did fish and wildlife, so I wasn't necessarily looking right to get into aquaculture. But seeing, like, you know, yourself, like you're saying, being able to use your undergrad and the position you're in, but also to follow a dream of, you know, working in the environment and out in the, and some of the best, you know, sceneries in Canada has to offer. And I think that's pretty great to have that opportunity. We joke about it all the time. I don't know if it's the kind of the environmental aspect of the jobs, but both myself and the other agricultural assistant, we both kind of, you know, put everything we owned in our cars and just kind of like went where the work was and like try to get as much, you know, experience outdoors so that we could follow the passions that we have. And I think it's pretty cool to hear everyone's background and see how everyone kind of ends up where they are, because I know a lot of people put a decent amount of effort to get themselves in the place they are. But Speaking of Cermaq and, you know, your opportunity that you have had there, is there any current work opportunities with Cermaq Canada? And, like, if so, where can people go to apply or even to keep an eye out for any opportunities coming up?
As we talked about before in the interview, there's, of course, a lot of farms at Cermaq. So there's usually pretty constant opportunities, whether it's, working in a more administrative job in the office or, you know, starting as a technician on one of our farms. And where Cermaq usually posts those is usually through the, you know, job boards online. So Indeed, you can also go to Cermaq.com and they have their postings for all their their Canadian positions on their website there. And Cermaq, of course, uses a lot of social media as well. So if you follow them on Facebook or Instagram or Twitter, all the job postings that we have coming out are posted there as well.
Perfect. That's all the questions I have for you today. I don't know if you have anything to add before we sign off.
I don't think I have too much to add. I wanted to thank you for inviting me to this interview today. It's been great chatting, and I wish you the best with all of your other future interviews that you have planned.
Thank you so much, and I owe you a big thank you for joining me today all the way out from a barge out in the ocean and sharing with us the work that you are doing specifically and how the benefits of Cermaq Canada has within the aquaculture industry. And same thing, I'll post some of those links for Cermaq down in the description. So if anyone watching this wants to check out Cermaq, they can just follow the links below. Hey guys, I hope you liked the video today. If you did, please swim on over and hit the like button and subscribe. Comment below if you have any questions you want answered in any of our future videos. Hope to see you next time.